सो
Okay, we start off with the diagnostic test. So this is the floor plan or diagnostic testing on COVID. Whom to test? What about RT-PCR? About the rapid antigen test? About the antibodies? About the clinical correlation? About the CT chest as a diagnostic tool in COVID? What is COVID panel blood test and additional information? You need all these things for you to really trace your patient and properly understand his disease and where to be treated and how to be treated. So this will be the floor plan, and we start about the first one, the whom. As you see here, this curve here shows days from the infection to symptoms of onset. All of us know that the estimated incubation period is around 7 to 10 days, and during this period only we are going to test. When the patient is exposed, when there is an history of contact and there is an history of exposure, you would like to test a patient. So the median incubation period is 5.1 days, and 11.5 days is the symptom of onset is the maximum. So this is what exactly, knowing this, we have to tailor our test. We can't test too early and say he is negative. We can't wait too late until the disease has progressed. So this is a ICMR recommendation, the Ministry of Health recommendation, whom to test. All symptomatic people who have history of travel, that is gone now, there is no need for travel now, had come in contact with a confirmed case, that's more important. Healthcare workers, all hospitalized patients with SARI, that is severe acute respiratory illness or influenza-like illness or severe pneumonia, any type of pneumonia. So asymptomatic patients who have direct or high-risk contacts of confirmed cases should also be tested between the 5th and the 14th day coming into his or her contact. Direct and indirect risk include those living in the same household. For example, a member of the household is positive. It is imperative that all the persons living, including the servants, need to be tested to find out the case. So ICMR approves several test centers day by day, and online real-time updating is done about the result, and then list is available online. And to date, RT-PCR and point of care tests are there, and also we have the antibody tests that are not diagnostic. So we have to learn about that, when not to do the antibody test. Report may take 24 hours if you are doing RT-PCR. Consider positive until the result is there. This is very important. Suppose somebody has symptoms and I tested, or the RT-PCR is still awaited. Means he suspect COVID and we have to treat them as positive only unless ruled otherwise. Know the COVID test center near you. Government testing centers are there. Private labs are also empowered now. There is mobile vans are coming and then testing, and then home testing also is available. In cities like Bangalore, we have camps also being conducted by health authorities in the different campuses. They come and sit here and do the test free of cost for all the residents of the apartment complexes there. 2 days back we had here, and we have a huge apartment complex of around 13,000 people. So many people got tested and some of them are detected positive. Now, so there are two types of scenarios: low suspicion COVID and high suspicion COVID. What are those? People who have symptoms or people who have contact with a known case or high suspicious. Low suspicious, they are asymptomatic, they don't have any symptoms, they don't have any history of contact, and you do a test in the hospital setting, in the non-hospitalized setting. If it is positive, fine. If it is negative, it has to be repeated. For low suspicion, we don't have to repeat the test. Now, the government of India, Modi's Prime Minister's, beloved Prime Minister's slogan is test, track, and treat. So we have the test for identifying the patients and the mechanism for tracking their contact and treating those who are positive appropriately. Real-time RT-PCR, this is called RT-PCR, is the real-time PCR. Quantitative PCR, if you add a small Q there before PCR, it is a quantitative PCR. Otherwise, it is yes, no. Yes, no means it doesn't tell you the load, But if it is quantitative PCR, it gives the cycle time. I'll tell you what is cycle time a little later. Average time is around 14 to 24 hours, depending on the lab and where you are. The another test is called the TrueNAT and CBNAT. These are also nucleic acid amplification test. When I say NAT, it means nucleic acid amplification test. So CBNAT and TrueNAT are very similar to your gene expert of your TB, where there is a cartridge and the sample is processed, and then it can process up to 1 to 4 samples only at a time. But the turnaround is very faster. In around half an hour to 90 minutes, the report will be available. Whereas RT-PCR, it can take up to 90 samples in one go, and it takes around 14 to 24 hours. So this is a big basic difference. But majority of the labs are doing RT-PCR. Now the current capability of ICMR, as on 1st of October, the numbers are here: 11,100 public sector and 780 private sector labs are empowered. RT-PCR 951 centers, TrueNAT are 781 centers, and TBNAT are CBNAT are 129. CBNAT is same as TrueNAT almost. So these are the various laboratories, and one wants to go and look at the current scenario about the testing laboratories, where are they listed. The link is given. If you just click the link, it is a clickable link. You can just go there and then click on the link, and you will be able to go to that website. I'm not going there. Now, there is another thing that has come out very recently, let's say last 2 months, and now it's very popular among all of us, is standard QCOVID-19 antigen kit. It is antigen detection, not antibody. Antibodies are available, but they are of not much use. The antigen kit, COVID-19 antigen kit, also called the RAT, rapid antigen test, RAT test. ICMR has approved this, and this is again RT-PCR methodology only, but then it is reduced into a small card-like thing. You have the pregnancy test card, no? Like that, the card will be there. If one line is positive, it is control. If two lines are coming, it is positive. Two lines means test positive, one line is test negative. So C and T will be there. C should be positive for the kit to be valid, and T also, if it is positive, the patient is positive. What they do? They just collect the nasopharyngeal NP swab, and the swab is put into a small vial-like thing, and then it's made to empty the viral particles or whatever are the secretions into the small tube-like thing, and by rotating it. So now the VTM, viral transport medium, or the diluent there, it contains the virus, viral particles or whatever it is, and a drop of that with the filler is taken and put on the card, and read in around 15 minutes to 30 minutes. Should not be read before 15 minutes, should not wait beyond 30 minutes. That is the rapid test. So in around 15 minutes, we know whether it is positive or not. Of course, we have got the two types of immunoglobulins, immunoglobulin G and immunoglobulin M. So immunoglobulin M is the one which comes faster, and immunoglobulin G is the later phase. These are antibody tests which are not very useful. I'll tell you why they are not useful. The government of India and most of the international agencies have said this is not the right way to test. So we will not use an antibody test. So what test I use? Either I use an RT-PCR or a RAT test. Now let us go further. So who are to be tested? Common COVID diagnostic methods. This is an RNA amplification test, and typically indicative of current infection. If it is positive, it doesn't tell whether somebody has got COVID 100 days back. Now only it is current infection, unlike an antibody which tells about the old infection. Sources specimens are NP swab, nasopharyngeal swab, oropharyngeal swab, nasal aspirate, sputum, bronchial lavage, tracheal aspirate, respiratory tract, any secretion. Considerations are primary method of COVID diagnosis is RT-PCR. This RT-PCR, several kits are there which are targeting that several antigenic determinants of the virus. The most commonly used determinant is the ORF1B. ORF is open reading frame of the virus. It has got, we have seen last time that it has around 10 open reading frames, out of which 1B is targeted, and also the spike protein also is targeted. These are the two targets and nucleic acid also is targeted in some tests. So these are the various antigenic points which are being tested here. Now this I am talking about the point of care or the NAT test, which is it uses a drop of the not blood here, in this case secretions there, and these secretions they go on the medium there, and then if one is controlled and two is test positive, and if only test is positive and control is not positive, such a test we should not take. This is as simple as the pregnancy card test or the hepatitis B card test which we use in our routine clinical practice. Now, what is the sensitivity and specificity of these tests? You must understand these two words very clearly. A specific test confirms the disease. A sensitive test can rule out the disease. Means what? If let's say one person has given a test, if the test is positive, it means specific for the virus. The specificity of this test is 100%. If it is there, means it is there. RT-PCR positive means positive. Suppose it is negative, can I rule out the disease? That's where the sensitivity comes. Ruling in the disease, specificity is important. It is no doubt 100%. Rule out the disease, somebody RT-PCR is negative. Can I say he doesn't have it? No, we cannot. Why? Because this is where exactly the sensitivity comes. There are what are called the false negatives. How many are there? Around 70 to 90% is the sensitivity, that if you do 100 tests, 30 of them may be negative in spite of they having the virus in the body. What are the reasons? We will see in the next slide. If somebody is negative, what I should do? I should repeat it after 3 days. And if the symptoms are there, of course, assess them with the other methodologies like CT and then decide. Now you can see here that asymptomatic and symptomatic, the blue wall color, deep blue color is the asymptomatic and the red color is the symptomatic. So in both of them, the OR of one antibody and the nucleic acid antigen, both of them almost similar, whether asymptomatic or symptomatic, the virus yield of for both the targets is quite the same. IgG is not very useful, we'll come to that. Now look at this graph. This summarily tells you what is happening in the system. There is one blue line, light blue line on the top. That light blue line is the viral load. Okay, that light blue line is the viral load there. So the light blue line that I am showing here with my cursor there, that is the viral load that comes off as a 0 day pre-symptomatic or asymptomatic phase, 0 to 5 days. By around 7-8 days it peaks. The red line there is the symptom line. They start having the symptoms from day 0 to day 5 and peaks up by 5-7 days and goes on by 10 to 15 days and symptoms drop. Then there is an IgM and the IgG. The yellow line is the IgM and the green line is the IgG, and the sensitivity of these two assays is also increasing as the days go by. So what exactly this graph means? It means the viral excretion starts much earlier than the symptoms. You can see that difference between these two. So viral excretion starts much earlier than the symptoms, and initially the antibodies are not positive. They take around 10 days to develop the antibodies for them to peak. So if we use an antibody test, we will be calling many people negative and not treating them. That is why we don't use an antibody test for diagnosis. It can be used for epidemiological purposes. So for diagnosis, symptoms are a good lead, and then of course the RT-PCR or the NAT test is the good lead. Now this again is a way of looking at it. PCR likely to be positive when detection is unlikely during this phase, in their pre-symptomatic 1 to 2 weeks before the symptoms. Here, the very unlikely that this one will be positive even if you do a test. But then the PCR is likely to be positive by this period. That is why we all insist that you should test everybody contact or a symptomatic within the first 1 week itself. Beyond that, again the PCR is less likely to be positive, and finally the PCR will become negative after the 3 or 4 weeks time. By then the antibody detection starts. So antibodies in this disease cannot be the first line of diagnosis because they appear very late. you cannot really understand whether the patient is positive or not by looking at an antibody test. So please don't order that. Then what I should order? Look for the symptoms and look for also the RT-PCR and the RAT test, which are one of the two. Now, this again is a very simple way of understanding. The first one is the symptoms, the SARS-CoV RNA excretion, the black one. The green one is the IgM and the red one is the IgG. As you know, the initial response will be IgM. It drops by about 3 weeks. After that, what happens? The IgG starts appearing at the IgG is the initial response is the IgM. This is the green color. The red color is the IgG. It starts appearing at the 2 weeks. And this is probably the prolonged antibody or the neutralizing antibody or the memory antibody that we have. This is true for any disease. Any disease, the acute response is IgM and the late response is the IgG. Here also it is the same. But unfortunately, this year, unlike in dengue and other infections, here the IgG peaking is not occurring until 2 weeks. So the IgM peaking. Like that IgG, of course, we don't use for diagnosis. This is to say somebody has suffered COVID and say that they are immune. So the diagnosis is basically resting on virus detection, the RT-PCR, not on the antibodies. Now the rapid diagnostic test I told you, there is also the enzyme linked immunosorbent test, ELISA, neutralizing assays are there, chemiluminescence tests are there. All of them, they have very high specificity, but the sensitivities are rather lower, a little better with the neutralizing assays compared to the other assays. So this is all about this slide. Now come to this one. WHO interim guidance on lab testing for SARS-CoV in suspected symptomatic human cases. Suppose routine confirmation of COVID-2 infection is based on the detection of the unique sequence of RNA in the NAT in the RT-PCR. Okay, now what are the causes for somebody throwing a negative result in spite of having the virus? Poor specimen quality, not from the nasopharynx, they have not properly collected. Timing of the collection, too early in the disease, the virus excretion is not there. 3, the specimen is not handled properly. 4, there are technical reasons in this one. The commonest reason is too early you have tested, means somebody is symptomatic and they test positive and we tested his household contact. They have not got the virus, they are in the asymptomatic phase. We have tested too early, that's why they are negative. What I need to do, if it is negative, we have to repeat after 3 days. Now come here. This is a very important statement made by the Infectious Disease Society of America. This is a small print. I'm going to tell you what it says, that they have given a directive, don't test the household contacts until they are symptomatic. And within 24 hours, international community reacted and withdrew the statement and saying, no, we have to test all the contacts of the person who is positive. Not only the household, the persons whom he comes in contact with, profession, in the office, if he is a driver, the person whom he has driven, all those are the contacts for that. So you have to test all the asymptomatic contacts also. Now, look at the T-cell response. The T-cell response for spike protein, for membrane protein, for nucleocapsid protein. For all of them, the T-cell response, the comparison bars are there, healthy donors, and then 20-20 healthy donors, exposed family members, convalescent people who are beyond the serious people and mild people. So all of them are mounting the T-cell response to both the spike protein, membrane protein, as well as the nucleocapsid protein when compared to healthy donors and healthy, other people of 2019 or 2020. So exposed family members also are throwing these T-cell responses. This is a new information. Summary, how long this will last? This will last around, the T-cell response here is CD4 and CD8. Recall responses present in 41% of the seronegative individuals and exposed family members 9 out of 28 and healthy individuals 5 out of 31. So all this boils down to, it is not only a B-cell immunoglobulin M and G mediation, there is also T-cell mounted response also is there in this particular disease, particularly in those who are asymptomatic and also who are symptomatic with mild disease as well as severe disease. Now, are the antibodies protective? That is another big question every one of us have. Supposing somebody gets COVID infection and he develops an antibody, is it a non-neutralizing antibody or is it a neutralizing antibody? If it is non-neutralizing antibody, it is just an antibody response and doesn't protect at all. If it is neutralizing antibody, it is going to be protective for second infection for him. So how long that lasts? We have been into this pandemic for around 6 to 9 months in different countries. And today we know that around 120 days is the minimum lasting of the antibodies we are seeing. We don't know whether it will last even longer unless we have some more time has to elapse. Maybe by next year we know all these COVID positive patients if they are having any antibodies left. In some people, the immune response is not very prominent. In such cases, the neutralizing antibodies are dropping after some time. But in general, they are persisting for at least 9 weeks to 12 weeks, 90 days to 120 days. So this is the thing. Antibodies by age and severity, we understand that people who suffered a severe disease, they had a more antibody response. And age, peculiarly, elderly people are having more antibodies at the end of the day. They are going to have a lasting antibody response in the elderly people. So serology diagnosis, now that today's recommendation is antibody test results should not be used, underline the word, should not be used to diagnose someone with active SARS-CoV-2 infection or COVID-19. So the COVID-19 IgM or IgG rapid tests have no role to play in the acute diagnosis of COVID-19 virus infection. COVID-19 IgG, IgM rapid tests will miss patients in the early stage of disease when they are really infectious to the other people. So by doing the test, we are harming the individual and calling him negative and also harming the community because we're calling him negative, we are allowing him to mix with other people and he would transmit the disease. So don't, several laboratories I know, many people are going and please do one COVID test. These people are asking when they give blood sample for sugar or cholesterol and they are doing an antibody test, they are saying that positive or negative, which means nothing. Please don't use the antibody test at all. The labs are promoting you another 600 you pay, I will do COVID antibody test. No, that is no use. If it is positive, what does it mean? It means we would have suffered the infection long back. What infection, what information is useful for me? It is whether it is protective or not, I don't know. I can't be having a false sense of security. Okay, my COVID antibodies are positive, so I won't get COVID. That is not the scenario. And also, if it is negative, I don't know whether I got infected or not, because I mean, if it is the early phase of infection, it will not get detected. So either way, it is not going to be very helpful. So don't, yield to the pressure to write COVID antibody test to a patient, or if the lab is insisting that they would do with 500 rupees more, please don't allow them to do it. We are not in a stage to use antibodies for diagnosis at all. Of course, what is their role? We want to use the COVID-19 antibodies for seroconversion in the community. There are 5 or 6 studies published in this country from Pune, from Agra, from Delhi, and from Bombay slums, and also from the Thyrocare. All these studies are showing the seropositivity of Indian scenario is now around 30 to 40%, which means these people are, they didn't have COVID symptoms, they were COVID negative, but the antibodies are positive. Means what? Means that there is asymptomatic infection going on and herd immunity is building up. It is good, but doesn't mean unlocking is unmasking. We should not unmask and go and invite the disease. If by nature we acquire it and then have the herd immunity, that is a different story. Okay. Now, yes, the other day I told you in epidemiology that what is called the R0 or R0. This R0 was to around 2.8 or even more than that, around 3-4 in some country. In our country, it was 2.8 to start with. Today, it is receding to 1. If the R0 is less than 1, the epidemic will stop. In many states, it is around 1.2, 1.3, like that. Even assuming the estimates are slightly poor, even allowing for 20-30% of error in that, the R0 in India is not more than 1.5, which means we are coming somewhere nearer to the R0 of 1, which will be ending the epidemic. Now, look at these things. This is serology for epidemiological purposes. That's a different story. Suppose at the end of the year, the government of India orders random sample survey of all the serology in big metros and all the places for random sampling. And if we know how many people are antibody positive, and we may say, yes, these people have suffered. And this is the rate of COVID infection in India. For epidemiological purposes, antibodies are useful. Not for clinicians, not for patients to ask for it, not for the labs to promote those things. So this is what exactly is happening. Now, this is a very wonderful slide, and summary slide tell you there are clinical phases, diagnosis and treatment, epidemiology. You see the first part of it, the exposure, the symptomatic course and the asymptomatic course. People can take two types of courses. One is the symptomatic course, the other is the asymptomatic course. If they take the symptomatic course, once they are exposed here, these exposed people whoever is susceptible, then these susceptible people, when they are exposed, develop latent infection or asymptomatic infection or a very typical symptomatic infection. This is what is exactly called the incubation period. This is what exactly is the incubation period here. So latent infection means asymptomatic susceptible, and then the people who have developed symptomatic people, they develop the infection. Symptom onset is here, and then this is the nucleic acid test, starts appearing positive here, peaks by around 5-6 days, and then slowly wanes off. When my IgM occurs, IgM occurs after 2 weeks. So we should not do the IgM for diagnosis. And then the IgG is the memory antibody or the long-lasting antibody, which starts around 2 weeks, peaks by around 4-5 weeks, and that is the IgG. So this is the symptomatic phase, and this is the symptomatic between 12 to 14 days time, where people get very sick, some people, and this is the convalescent phase where they recover. So the other model is asymptomatic course. Who will be asymptomatic? People who had less viral exposure or who are not susceptible due to various reasons, by age, by gender, by genetics, and they are exposed, but they may not develop infection. And then the antibody response is more or less similar in them also. They have a long convalescent phase, they very quickly throw the infection, and they don't have the symptomatic phase of 2 weeks or 3 weeks. So this is about the very important way of looking at the test, the antibody, antigen, symptoms in symptomatics and asymptomatic. Now, look at this slide. This is more a clinically applicable slide. These are the days of clinical symptoms, and this is what you do. The viral response dwindles by around 2 weeks time. It started with a high load here, and the viral response dwindles here. Whereas the inflammatory response, what we say, the cytokines, we are going to see in our next lecture, but in the pathogenesis we have seen, all the inflammatory responses start coming up from day 7 to day 14, day 21 and beyond. So this is called the stage of pulmonary phase or stage 2, or stage of hyperinflammation or the immune inflammation phase, stage of early infection. So most of the people will have early infection. They may not go into pulmonary phase, 80-85%, and they will never end up with hyperinflammation. Some in stage 1 will go into stage 2 pulmonary phase. It is divided into 2A and 2B. 2A being the people without desaturation and pulmonary phase. They have pneumonitis. It is no more an ILI illness. This is the ILI, influenza-like illness. Here there is a pneumonia. There is involvement of the lung. And then 2A is the without desaturation, 2B with oxygen saturation is falling. So we need to detect people in this stage and see that they do not go into the serious disease. And here a lot of interventions are mentioned here. When we come to that, I will show you, when we are treating again, I will show you the same slide and which intervention has to be used and when to be used. That's a very important, crucial thing. So another thing is radiology. Radiology is very important for all of us, because majority of the time in the early phase of the disease, virus is not seen. So how do we get to know whether the lung involvement is there or not? By doing an X-ray chest or a CT chest. And of course, monitor the other markers like white cells, lymphocytes, platelets, CRP, D-dimer, LDH, liver enzymes, and all these things. So we'll go a little detail into those things. Because before that, the recent advances for the diagnosis of virus itself, nucleic acid amplification based tests are there, saliva based test. This is called the saliva direct. That means patient will just collect the saliva on his own without there being any healthcare worker, and that is diluted in a small tube, the saliva, and a drop of that is taken and placed on the testing medium, and you know whether it is positive or negative. That is called saliva direct. 15 to 20 minutes or sometimes at the most by 1 hour is that the results are available. This will be available very soon into our system there, and we will be able to empower the patients to test the saliva when they have minor symptoms itself. Then there is another called the rapid plex. What is rapid plex? It is a sensor. So what it does is something like a biosensor. It takes several data into consideration, and then it is a sort of machine reading whether the virus is there or not. This is also going to come, maybe a little longer it will take. And today, just like you know, our telephone recognizes us by looking at the face, these sensors recognize the virus from the human body by looking at the different images of the nose and the face, and the rapid plex is going to be helpful like that. The another test which has come into the vogue now is called the Feluda COVID-19 test. ICMR has approved this, and Government of India has taken it, and this is available. This is from the Tata group of companies. They have developed this. This is the technology called the CRISPR technology, and this is a genome editing tech for diagnosis of the disease, and mainly uses indigenously developed, and in collaboration with the IIT Kanpur, this test has been developed. And it gives a result within around 2 hours, and it is an RT-PCR equivalent. So all these things are promising things. So many are in the pipeline. We'll come to know in the next time when we are speaking about this. So what are the tests I order? This is what is called the COVID panel. We order normally for our patients in our labs, in our hospital, we order these things. CBC and ESR to look at the lymphopenia, leukopenia, and thrombocytopenia. Particularly, lymphopenia is diagnostic of seriousness of the disease, and also leukopenia and thrombocytopenia. CRP and ferritin are acute phase reactants and tell about the cytokine excess. And then you have LDH, CPK, liver enzymes, and serum albumin that tell about the tissue and the liver involvement. Procalcitonin will tell about bacterial superinfection, particularly leukocytosis associated with higher procalcitonin. Will tell us there is a bacterial superinfection. Drop I tells about the tissue damage and the myocardial damage. D-dimer, prothrombin time, partial prothrombin time, and fibrinogen and thrombo, these tell about the thromboinflammation. Another new finding we all are aware now is that hypolipidemia. Hypolipidemia means people will have low LDL, low TG. This again indicates the severity of the COVID. Interleukin-6 is estimated in some laboratories, not available everywhere, but this is a very good cytokine marker, which is a cytokine storm. Once in every 5 days, if there is no severe disease, otherwise alternate days you have to do. Every 2 to 3 days we have to do. So now you write down on your notes that what are all the tests you order once the patient is admitted. CBC, ESR, CRP, ferritin, LDH, CPK, liver enzymes, GOT, GPT, procalcitonin, drop I, D-dimer, PTT, fibrinogen, lipid panel, and then interleukin-6. How frequent I do? At the day 0 and day 5. And if this disease is progressing, every 48 hours you have to do. That is the frequency of doing this test. I have also shown you each one of them, what do they say. Some of them show about the disease, some about the cytokines, some about the thromboinflammation, some about the tissue injury. Each marker has got a value to predict certain things that are happening in the body. Now, the laboratory parameters are lymphopenia, I told you, immunological response to the virus, leukocytosis, when there is superinfection, neutrophilia, again when there is superinfection, and then increased values in viral and viremia and all. Thrombocytopenia, consumption coagulopathy, CRP, again any viral infection, and then value of procalcitonin, bacterial sepsis, LDH, pulmonary injury. LDH is more or less specific for pulmonary injury, aminotransaminases, liver injury, bilirubin, liver injury, creatinine about the acute kidney injury, cardiac troponins about heart, albumin about the liver function, prothrombin about the coagulopathy. Remember, here the coagulopathy is not, you know, say disseminated intravascular coagulation. It is more microthrombolization, microthrombi, particularly in the lung. D-dimer is also a very useful test. So these are, apart from the nucleic acid amplification test, for the lab diagnosis, we require the COVID panel also. Now, what are the predictors of thrombosis? D-dimer, fibrinogen, CRP, ferritin, all of them are, studies have proved that they are predictor of the thromboinflammation. So we know about those things, and what are the normal values that they differ from lab to lab. Always use your normal values of your lab and compare your patient values with the normal value, and also serial rise or fall is indicative. Suppose interleukin is normally is around 0.5. If it is, you know, 10 to start with on the third day, and again on the sixth day it is 28 or 30 or 40, we know that the patient immune inflammation is progressing or cytokines are worsening. So serial readings, either up or down, will tell you about the patient's prognostic indication, whether it is improving or deteriorating. So that is the reason. And of course, the fourth important thing is the chest radiography. Chest radiography is a must today, wherever the facility is available, on the day 1 or day 0, and also on the day 5, and at the time of saying he is cured, that is the normal protocol. If they are escalating, of course, depending on the necessity, CT has to be done. So what are the CT findings? I would like to go to a website and show you, which is a very nice way of looking at. Now, the illness is classified as mild, severe, and critical by your clinical thing, depending on the hypoxia and all. You also have to give the PCR test result to the CT people when you send, whether you have done or not. If done, what is the result? Then the common thing is GGO, they write. What is GGO? Ground glass pattern is the most common COVID finding, and it is diffuse. They are usually multifocal, bilateral, peripheral. But early in the phase of the disease, GGOs may present as unifocal lesions, most commonly in the inferior lobe of the lung. That is the least ventilated. So you ask them always, that's why the prone ventilation and prone position and all. So these are usually multifocal, usually bilateral, peripheral. But sometimes they can be unifocal in the lower lobe. Okay? CT image here, you can see here. Can you see the CT image there? Can you see, sir? Are you able to see the CT image?
Yeah, we are able to see.
Yeah, now I am scrolling it. I'm giving you a video of the this is what is called the typical ground glass appearance. You can see, as the ground glass, you all know, invisible glass we put, no, the ground glass. Lung has become like a ground glass, and it's peripheral. Multiple peripheral ground glass opacities are GGOs. This is a very florid case. For example, I have shown, but they won't be like this. If this is the case, they will be in the ICU, probably on the ventilation. So this is one finding. The other finding that you need to know is crazy paving. Crazy paving means as though this is paved at the end, edges like that. So these are the crazy paving sign. It thickened interlobar and intralobular combination with ground glass pattern is called the crazy paving. GGO, peripheral, multifocal, usually multiple and bilateral, and sometimes unifocal to start with. The third one is vascular dilatation. I'll show you now the enlarge. You see the vascular dilatation. Can you see the blood vessels in the lung? They are dilated so much. So this is vascular dilatation is because of the immune inflammation and endothelitis. Typical finding in the area of the ground glass region. So there is a ground glass region through which you see the blood vessels traversing as though they are going into a tumor mass. That is the vascular dilatation. Then what is called the traction bronchitis. You see here, the bronchi are inflamed here. These are the bronchi, and this is called the traction bronchitis. Bronchi are pulled open, and you can see the bronchial shadows very clearly within the ground glass pattern. Okay, what are the four things we have seen till now? One is the GGO, the other is the First one is the GGO, second one is the crazy paving, third one is the vessel dilatation, fourth one is the bronchiectasis with the bronchitis there, that is ground glass traction bronchiectasis. You can see here the bronchi have become very dilated. It is called the traction bronchiectasis. And finally, you have got the subpleural bands or architectural distortions. You see here, this is the subpleural band there under the pleura and the distortion of the lung tissue there. So these are the various things. If you want to enable the scroll and see the video here, you can see how the ground glass opacities are appearing, peripheral, you see, nicely. And you can okay. Now you will be seeing a score. They say 5x25, 1x25, 6x25, 20x20. What is all that? So there should be some understanding about the clinician should know what the radiologist is talking. It is not like that, you know, they just wave their hand in the air and then pick up some number 5x50. There is a way of doing it. So less than 5% involvement, 5 to 25% involvement, 26 to 49, 50 to 75, more than 75 of a particular region of the lung. How many lobes are there? How many are there? 5. 2 on one side and 3 on the other side. Total 5 lobes. For each lobe, you give a score of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, depending upon the extent of involvement. So the minimum score could be 0, that is no involvement. 0 into 5 lobes is 0, so 0 score. Let's say there is 1% involvement in one lobe. 1 into 5, that is 5 will be the minimum score. So you have to multiply by the number of lobes that are affected plus the plus the intensity of involvement of each lobe. There are 5 levels of involvement, from less than 5% to more than 75%. There are 5 lobes. 5 into 5, 25 could be the highest score. Highest score means 75% of involvement is there, not in one lobe, in all the 5 lobes. Then it becomes 25x25. Okay, 10x25 means there are 5 zones are involved, there is a second level of involvement, 2 into 5, 10%. Like that you have to score. This is what is called the severity scoring system. So I showed you, it's a beautiful website. I shared the link also in the presentation, which will be there with Dr. Sudhir Garu. He will circulate to you. So ground glass, first of all, you have to tell whether the disease is, what stage is the disease, you have to write on the request, and you have to tell the PCR report also to the radiologist. And CT chest, GGO, this is the GGO, we have seen the GGO. And then you have the crazy paving, which we have seen. Then the vessel dilatation because of the immune thromboinflammation and microthrombi, and traction bronchiectasis because of the severe immune inflammation there, and subpleural bands. Any one or more of these can be there in 1, 2, 3, 4 or all the 5 parts of the lung. The 5 parts being the 5 lobes. The extent could be less than 5%, 5 to 25 is grade 2, 26 to 49 is 3 score, 50 to 75 scores 4 and 5. So if I want to know the summary score, I have to know the severity in each lobe multiplied by the number of the lobes involved. So minimum can be no involvement 0, maximum can be 5 into 5, 25. Now this is all. Then what we have to do? Initial pattern of the CT. If you look at the CT, bilateral ground glass of pacification, 88% of the patients whom we examine for CT, the abnormal CTs are ground glass. Bilateral involvement also 88%. Posterior distribution 80%. Multiple lobe involvement 79%. Peripheral distribution 76%. Consolidation is rather rare. So what COVID pneumonia, how do I diagnose? It must be ground glass opacity, most important. Second thing is it should be bilateral. Three, it should be posterior. Four, multiple lobes will be involved. If that is there, I can say, yes, this is a COVID pneumonia. So now, various images are given in this website. You can go, and they will also, this is the report that you have to write up at the end of it. how to write the report also is shown. Various other radiological patterns also are given here. More importantly, the CT of the chest is done, CT angiography of the chest is done to know whether there is a pulmonary embolism. The pulmonary embolism is a feature on the 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. In that range of the disease, one must look for pulmonary embolism if there is lung involvement. How does this occur? Not the embolus coming from the peripheral blood veins somewhere in the DVT coming and sitting here. This is not an embolic phenomena. More it is a pulmonary thrombosis itself. We call it as pulmonary embolism, but this is a microthrombosis of the circulation due to immune thrombosis of the local area, which we have already seen. So this is, there is a template, COVID-19 CT report template, and one has to use the template and then write the report. Lots of other X-rays also are there, and I am not going to go into the details of that, but use that website, a beautiful website for us to know that this one, and I will now stop sharing that. Okay, we saw that the chest CT, we went into the details of that through the website and understood what are the changes here, day 6, day 9, day 11, day 17, day 23, that's also there. And then these are the external links I told you. And then look at the immune response in SARS-CoV. SARS-CoV people, either they will get a low virus titer, asymptomatic, and then recover, mild illness, they recover. Or they have a high viral titer, and then they go in for the cytokine storm, activation of macrophages, monocytes, neutrophils. They release a lot of chemical molecules, cytokines, IL-6, IL-10, TNF, and then all the other factors. And they also affect the CD4 and CD8, both are reduced, neutrophils also are reduced. And that could again last for some days, and they may normally recover also. Or they could end up in a high viral titer, severe infection, severe cytokines, antiviral and anti-cytokine storm, treatment is given, ICU care, lung injury, septic shock, organ failure, coagulopathy, and death. These are the various ways it can progress. This is the natural history of the disease. So if there is adequate immune response, this is the picture. The inadequate immune response or hyperactive immune response, this is the picture. So reinfection, the question is, a person who recovered from COVID, can he get COVID once again? As of now, there are a few cases of reinfection. During the 90-day asymptomatic period following recovery, retesting is not recommended given the potential for viral shedding. Because if the person develops new symptoms during the 90-day period following recovery, no other diagnosis identified, then evaluation for reinfection may be warranted. Not very well documented as of now, but we don't know. We have to be into the disease for some more days or some more months, then we know the reinfection. Immune-related risk factors also, older persons have got impaired B and T cell responses, so they suffer more immune-related disease, impaired B cell response, impaired T cell response. Younger persons with impaired responses or dysregulated B and T cell responses may also be at risk. So CDC COVID-19 immunocompromised patients, for example, HIV patient, who is well treated, there is no reason to believe that, you know, they will have a different outcome than other persons. Simply because they are HIV positive doesn't mean they are well treated. Likewise, diabetics. Many diabetics are afraid and they call me, sir, I am a diabetic. Will I die with COVID? No. If your diabetes is well controlled, then generally the risk is same as the other persons. But usually these diabetics are around 60-65, and the age-related risk always is there. We can't make them younger. We can control the diabetes, but we can't make them 30 years, isn't it? Likewise, male gender also is associated with more disease, severe disease and fatality. We know that 66 versus 34 is the ratio between males and females in terms of mortality, and also in terms of severity also, 2/3 and 1/3. So this is the end of the story today, and we will come to case definition and triage on Monday. I will do that, and I will stop sharing here. If you have any questions, I am ready to take the questions. Please ask me. Before I close, I just summarize the take-home points. Number one, RT-PCR RAT test is the diagnostic tool. Antibodies are not the diagnostic tools because they don't develop until 14 days. Antibodies are useful to for epidemiological purposes. Doing antibody test on an individual will neither confirm the disease in the early part nor reassure the patient has recovered. No way it is possible, and we don't know whether the antibodies are neutralizing or non-neutralizing. The other tests are COVID panel. You must always look for COVID panel and see whether the patient is progressing into moderate and severe disease like COVID immunoinflammation, thromboinflammation, cytokine storm, and all those things can be looked at. And the frequency I told you, 0, 5, and every 5 days if he is normal, or every 2 days if the patient is deteriorating. Oximetry is an important clinical tool. Here I tell you there is another test I do. Of course, I'll comment on that when we are treating the patient. This is called the 6-minute walk test. What is this? So ask the patient to sit with rest and then read the oximeter. And the oximeter reading, let us say, is 98 or 96 or 95. Then you ask them to just do a plain 6-minute walk. At the end of it, again record the pulse oximetry. What is the inference? If there is a more than 3% drop in the oxygen saturation, or if the tachycardia is more than 120, or if the patient becomes symptomatic within that 6 months, it is a positive test for impending hypoxia. It is a very simple test. It can be done at the bedside. All you need to do is, the patient need not run, jog, do any weightlifting. Just plain walking at a normal speed, whether as though you walk from one room to another. With that walk, normally no lung should get desaturated in 6 minutes. In the early hypoxia or happy hypoxia, we see they get desaturated very early in that. So this is another important clinical test which you can use apart from the symptoms, and also the among the symptoms, the most important significant specific symptom is anosmia, or now lack of smell, and agousia, lack of taste. These are reported to be more than cough and breathlessness. Of course, cough and breathlessness are primary symptoms. Anosmia and lack of taste, you have to remember. And when you come to CT, don't depend on radiology people to come and give you the report. They're available, okay. Otherwise, you should be able to see, are there peripheral opacities? Are there multiple lobes are involved? Is it bilateral? If the things are there, then it is more likely COVID. And try and grade it, whether one lobe is affected, 2, 3, 5, and what is the extent, one level 1, level 2, level 3, level 4, level 5, total score would be 25. So these are the various ways you evaluate the patient: chemical, biochemical test, radiological information, and also the RT-PCR. Majority of our patients, in the first 2 or 3, 4 days, RT-PCR is negative. It doesn't mean that they don't have disease. Immediately you do a CT, you already see 5 by 25 or 10 by 25. So CT comes in very handy, particularly in the early diagnosis.
Sir, role of antibodies, they are saying depending antibody titers. If it is 16, there is no need to worry about COVID. If it is less, and you told that these antibodies are not at all useful, no sir.
I told you now, this has been extensively discussed today. Antibodies are two types, IgM to start with and IgG later on. IgM antibodies are never protective for any disease. They only show that the disease has occurred. That's okay. IgG antibodies are the so-called protective antibodies, are the memory antibodies. There are two types in that. One is IgG memory antibody non-neutralizing, and the other one is neutralizing. If it is non-neutralizing, it is simple memory and it doesn't protect. If it is neutralizing, it protects. From the studies, we know that most of the antibodies which we do after four weeks or 6 weeks are IgG neutralizing antibodies lasting up to 90 to 120 days. Beyond that, we have not gone into the disease. After some days or some months, we know whether they are going to last. It appears that it is not going to be a lifetime infection, lifetime immunity. It's not going to be a lifetime immunity. It appears from the clinical data, from the lab data now. Why? For example, if I get chikungunya, the antibodies are lifelong. I'll not get it. If I get chickenpox, it's lifelong immunity. Whereas here, lifelong COVID immunity will not be there. It's the question of how long you will have the immunity depends upon how much amount of antibody titer is mounted in the form of IgG neutralizing and how long it will last.